bit above Rao-Kalman's criteria. So in Rao-Kalman's stability criteria, you can know whether the closed loop ports are on the left half of the S-plane or on the right half of the S-plane, or third case, that is on the imaginary axis. But using Rao-Kalman's criteria, we can't know whether the nature of the control system is of what kind. So to overcome this limitation, there is a technique which is known as root locus technique. So using this root locus technique, what we are going to do, we are going to observe the path of closed loop ports. So the closed loop path, ports path is being observed using this technique, and then what we can do is we can identify the nature of control system. In this technique, we are going to use open loop transfer function, and using that we are going to know the stability of closed loop control system. So using an open loop transfer function for a closed loop control system, we are going to check its stability. Now what is the basis of root locus? So the basis of root locus is, in this we are going to see that it is the locus of roots of characteristic equation. So it is the locus of roots of characteristic equation by varying the system gain k. So the system gain k is varying from 0 to infinity. So the system gain k is being varying from 0 to infinity. In this case, our root locus diagram will be open. So the characteristic equation of the closed loop control system is 1 plus GSHS equals to 0. That is, or we can say 1 plus GH equal to 0. This S indicates that our G function, that is the gain, the forward gain, is in S domain. So the forward gain is in S domain, so it is written as GS, and HS is your unity feedback gain. Here GS is forward gain, and HS is unity negative feedback gain. That will S domain we are going to write. So F of S is written. So this is the notation for unity negative feedback in S domain is HS, and for forward gain is GS. So in this way we are going to write the characteristic equation as 1 plus GSHS equals to 0, or it can be written as 1 plus GH equal to 0. This S in this bracket can be skipped. Now further what we can see is, now this equation, characteristic equation, can further be represented as this. That is, in this the GS part can be written as K into NS over DS. So what is your K? K is basically your multiplying factor, and this NS portion is representing the numerator term, which is having the factored nth order polynomial of S. So this represents nth order polynomial of S. That is, this is a polynomial starting with the power of n, S to the power n order, and it goes on with some coefficients like a, S to the power n minus 1, and so on, till finally S to the power 0. So in this way, it is a polynomial expression, and in the numerator part ns, and ds is basically a denominator term which is having a factored nth order polynomial of S to the power n. And this numerator is S to the power nth polynomial, and this denominator is S to the power n polynomial, and k is your multiplying factor. So now further we are moving, that our resultant characteristic equation will be represented like this. Portion was indicating your GH value, or you can say GSHS value. So when this is substituted in your characteristic equation, it became 1 plus k ns over ds equals to 0. Like this. your characteristic equation 1 plus CH equal to 0, and here this value for GH was written like K equals to NS over DS from the previous expression. And now when you substitute this value with here, you get this resultant equation 1 plus K NS over DS equals to 0. Now further, taking LCM in this step, we obtain this DS equals to K NS equals to 0. So after taking LCM in this step, we are going to get this equation. Next, what we need to do is, we are going to take the cases. As you know, in the definition of root locus, we were taking system gain as varying. That system gain was varying from 0 to infinity for root locus diagram. So it was basically what your, the definition of root locus is, the locus of roots of characteristic equation by varying the system gain k from 0 to infinity. So we have obtained the characteristic equation. Now we are going to vary the k part from 0 to infinity, and then we are going to obtain your root locus diagram. So this was your final characteristic equation, and now we are going to place these different values of k. So first part, case 1, k equals to 0. So for this equation, Vs plus KNS equals to 0. When you place k equals to 0, then what comes? When here k is equals to 0, then resultant will be ds equals to 0. Then ds comes 0. That means what? That is the closed loop poles are equals to open loop poles when k is 0. So the closed loop poles are equals to open loop poles for k equal to 0 condition. Next case, that is for k equals to infinity. So when we are writing your this above equation, is written in this form. Basically, it was originally this way. 1 plus k ns over ds equals to 0. Now, in this equation, what we do is we divide by k. So here we get this, and this will be cancelled. And then, as we are dividing by this k, then we need to multiply by k also, then we are going to get this equation. So after obtaining this equation, when we solve, then actually this is the equation which we get is 1 by k plus ns by ds equals to 0. Then further we need to substitute k equal to infinity in this equation. Why we are writing this equation from the original ds equation, that the original equation was ds plus k ns equals to 0. So this equation was transformed to this one because here k is equals to infinity, we need to substitute in this equation. So if we are substituting here infinity, then that will not be in proper condition to solve. So here when we are writing infinity in one upon term, then it becomes 0, which is an exact form. So what we get, this term will become 0, and ns by ds equals to 0, that means ns will come out to be 0 for the second case. What does this mean? That for k equals to 0, we are getting ds equals to 0, and for k equals to infinite, we are getting ns equals to 0. So this means that closed loop poles are equal to open loop zeros when k is infinity. So closed loop poles are basically equal to your open loop zeros. In this case, here it will be zeros for k infinity. And whereas for k equals to 0 case, the closed loop poles are equal to open loop poles only when k is 0. But here for infinite, closed loop poles are equal to open loop zeros. Now next one we are going to see, that for these two cases, we can conclude that the root locus branches, they start at open loop poles and they end at open loop zeros. Because k equal to 0 is taken as starting point. So k equals to 0 and that will be your open loop series. Now further we are going to consider your angle condition and magnitude condition. So what are they? That is, angle condition is basically the points on the roof loops, that is, they satisfy the angle condition. So what all points there are on the root locus branches, they are going to satisfy your angle condition. So the angle condition is used to know whether the point exists on the root locus branch or not. So using the angle condition, we are going to check whether a point is existing on root locus branch or not. And we can find the value of A for the points on the root locus branches by using magnitude condition. So we can use the magnitude condition for points and then satisfy your angle condition. So the characteristic equation of closed loop control system. This closed loop control system has a characteristic equation of 1 plus GH equals to 0 and GH equals to 1 minus of 1 plus A0. Because your magnitude wise it is minus 1 and G0 is its angle. Now further we can see the phase angle part of GH equals to, that is the angle of GH is tan inverse 0 by minus 1. How this is obtained is, basically, if suppose GH equals to A plus JB, then the magnitude is basically under root of A square plus B square, and the angle part of it is tan inverse of B by A. So this B by A is your tan inverse part is angle condition. So here for obtaining angle part we are going to write tan inverse is 0 by minus 1. 0 by minus 1. So this gives you angle condition. And this tan inverse minus 0, or you can say tan inverse 0, is basically 2m plus 1 pi. So our angle condition will be 2m plus 1 pi. Angle condition is going to be 2m plus 1 pi. That is the phase angle. And this, the phase angle for GH equals to 2m plus 1 pi, and the angle condition is the point at which the angle of open loop transfer function is an odd multiple of 180 degree. So this is basically pi indicates 180 degree. And 2n plus 1 means if you are writing 2n, that means n is going to be any natural number, or you can say any integer number, and 2n makes it an even number. And so if we are going to write 2n plus 1, that is going to make an odd number. So it is generally mathematical expression, we are going to write 2n plus 1 into pi, that is an odd multiple of 180 degree. So this is going to be your angle condition, that is angle condition is the point at which your angle of the open loop transfer function is going to be an odd multiple of 180 degree. Next we are going to see magnitude condition for it. The magnitude condition is generally obtained from the same part. The magnitude condition of GS, that is, this GS is basically magnitude of GS is under root of minus 1 square plus 0 square. How? Because GS was our minus 1 plus J0, and using this we obtained angle of GH as in the previous expression 2n plus 1 pi. That is an odd multiple of pi, that is 180 degree, is your angle condition or phase angle. And the magnitude for this GH from here is under root of this minus 1 square plus 0 square. So minus 1 square plus 0 square makes it 1. So the magnitude is going to be 1, and the magnitude condition is the point that is which is satisfied the angle condition. So the magnitude condition, it is important that the point we are going to take for whose angle condition is already satisfied, at which the magnitude of the open loop transfer function is 1. So at that point your magnitude of open loop transfer function The root locus is basically a graphical representation in S domain. So this is a graphical representation in S domain, and it is symmetrical about the real axis. What we can see is generally for our S plane, let's suppose this is our S plane, and in this S plane, this is our real axis, and this is our imaginary axis. So for this, we are going to say that whatever our root locus obtained is going to be symmetrical about the real axis, that is this axis. We are going to say that it is symmetrical about this particular axis. So the way it looks above the axis, it will be the same as it looks below the axis. That is going to be a symmetry about the real value, sorry, the real axis. So this is basically a main condition, or can say a main observation from your root locus diagram. Next is, because the open loop poles and zeros, they exist in S domain having the value either as a real or complex conjugate pairs. So why do we obtain a real axis symmetricity in root locus diagram? Is because the open loop poles and zeros, they exist in S domain, and they have a value either they are having a first condition of linear real roots, or second, complex conjugate pairs. So accordingly, we are going to look the symmetricity condition of real, about real axis.